Endless runner games are some of the most addictive games around, and the Chrome Dino game is a real lifesaver when the internet goes down. I am pretty good at it, but I've always thought it could look cooler. That's why I decided to create my own experimental version in FlutterFlow, but with a fun, retro Mario twist. I managed to get the first working version of this game done in just 24 hours over the weekend, and that too without any custom code. Through this video series, I'll walk you through different parts of the game, and I plan to keep adding new features as we go. To begin, create your character images using AI. I have used the DALL-E 3 API. You can either use the API directly or use it via ChatGPT. So this is the prompt that I went with to create my cute retro dino on a skateboard, because that's what Gen Z dinos do these days. So now let's start a new FlutterFlow project in landscape desktop mode. Here we'll place a stack as the child for our homepage. This stack will be the foundation where all our game elements will be layered. Next, it's time to introduce our characters and obstacles. We add a new image child to our stack, which is our first player widget. Set the image source to an asset for this. Now, a crucial concept in building this game is understanding how elements are positioned in a stack. While they do stack on top of each other, Flutter's alignment properties offer us much more control. We can precisely position our child widgets within the stack, which will be key to developing our game. Let's consider the stack widget as a canvas here that runs an x-axis and a y-axis. We learned this in our math class, but for the sake of this video and people like me who didn't pay much attention in school, let's refresh some of the concepts. The x-axis runs horizontally from left to right, and the y-axis runs vertically from top to bottom. The point where these two axes intersect is known as the origin, which is the point where both the x and y values are zero. Typically, when dealing with a digital canvas, the origin is usually set at the top left corner of the canvas, but using the alignment widgets of Flutter, the origin is offset to actually the center of the screen, which makes it easier to position elements symmetrically. So in reference to our game, our player is at the origin of the screen right now, and this is how the positions change when the value of x or y or both update. Keeping a final game in mind, we know that the player is set here, and with the same concept, our cactus or obstacle will be placed at the opposite end but in the same y-axis. Now, in endless runner games such as the Chrome Dino, there is an illusion that the character is running towards the obstacles. However, it's usually the opposite. The game often keeps the character, like the dino here, stationary in terms of horizontal movement. And it's the obstacles, like the cacti, that move from right to left. This clever design choice creates the illusion of forward movement for the character. In these games, the character's jump is also a visual trick. The player moves only vertically, cleverly creating the illusion that the character is leaping over the obstacles. This means that the cactus widget will only move along its x-axis, while the player will change its position on the y-axis during jumps. Let's return to our builder and implement these dynamic movements for our characters. We'll begin by creating paid state variables like cactus x alignment for the cactus changing x value and the player y alignment for the player's changing y value during jumps. It's also important to establish cactus initial x and player initial y to mark their starting points. While most variables might start with an initial value of 1, for cactus initial x, I'm setting it to 1.2, because it positions the cactus just off screen, ready for its entrance. Now we can go ahead and update the variable source for the x alignment value of cactus widget and the y alignment of the dino player widget. Also, to make our debugging process smoother, it's a good idea to include a debug view. This would be a simple column widget displaying two text elements that show the real-time values of these variables, allowing us to track their changes throughout the game. So now with our game's base ready, let's get the cactus moving from right to left. We'll begin with a start game button. In the buttons action flow, we set up a periodic action to run tasks at regular intervals, like every 10 milliseconds. This functionality is crucial for regularly updating the cactus's X coordinate. So let's update the paid state variables here. The precision of the double type variable here is key, as it allows incremental adjustments, ensuring the cactus moves across the screen in a fluid, natural manner. However, this setup only covers part of the necessary logic. Currently, the cactus doesn't automatically return to its starting position to repeat the movement. To implement this, we can do a conditional check. This will check if the cactus has moved past a certain point on the left side of the screen. So the condition can be to check if cactus X alignment is less than or equal to, say, minus 1.5. Once it hits the point, we can reset the cactus's X coordinate to its initial value, allowing the movement cycle to start over. Now, as you can see in our test mode, the cactus movement will be looping till we add an action somewhere to stop this periodic timer. Probably when we restart the game or there is a collision. Well, we will get to that logic later. For now, let's make the dino jump. By now, we know that to create the jump, the player's Y value will update. But of course, the logic will be quite different from the cactus movement, right? When the jump begins, the character's Y value decreases on moving upwards. As the character reaches the peak of the jump, the Y value starts to increase, simulating gravity pulling the character back down. This continues till it returns back to its original Y coordinate, completing the jump cycle. To implement this, we need two new paid state variables. A Boolean jump is ascending, which can either be null, true, or false. And also the peak jump height, which is set to 0.5 at the moment. To enable jumping in our game, we add an action to the stack widget triggered by a single tap. The jump starts with setting jump is ascending to true. A periodic action is added, which is supposed to update every 20 milliseconds. We name the timer player jump and we add the rest of the jump logic inside this periodic action block. Now, if jump is ascending is set to true, we decrease the Y coordinate by 0.05 to simulate ascent. But now we must add the logic to let the player fall back to gravity. So once the peak height is reached, therefore the condition check where player Y alignment is less than or equal to peak jump height, then we can set the jump is ascending variable to false, starting the fall. Now this was the true block actions. Let's add the false block actions too. In this case, the player's Y coordinate increases by 0.05 as it goes down to show the gravity fall. And then we check if player Y alignment is greater than or equal to player initial value. If it's true, we can reset the jump is ascending variable to null and stop the periodic action to end the jump cycle. Let's see this in action in our test mode. We can also enhance the jump by adjusting the peak height to 0 for a longer jump. And further, we reduce the speed of the descent to create a more realistic physics-based jumping effect. For example, instead of the increment by 0.05, it can be set to 0.03 for a slower descent. And that's it. As you can see, we have established the basic framework of our game simply by utilizing the coordinate system concepts without the need for any custom code. In the next video, we'll talk about collision detection and adding more background elements to complete the picture. Stay tuned!